to do because they can't continue to walk in that way. You know, what's the sense? You know, you're missing the boat. So maybe that's that. He's got to wander that wilderness and get off that path and get has to got trust in Yahuwah at that point. But you know, I don't know. That's where the elders come in and we discuss it, and if we all are in agreement after much prayer, then that's how we execute that.
Yep. Agreed. And by the way, Richard, while you were talking, I hit the record button right at the tail end. So I'm just starting the recording. We're already getting into it. It's a good topic, worthy of recording. I think I went a little off topic on this verse. So we're in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 15.
Yeah.
Verse 15. Right.
Yeah, we finished that.
So we'll pick up there, but let's see, where was it? If a ruler, we were going over verse 22. We were just discussing before the recording started, verse 22 and on, when a ruler sins unwittingly. I think that the key here is unwittingly or unknowingly. So I don't think adultery is in that category, because, I mean, you know when you're committing adultery. There's no guessing about that. I think this has to do with other issues, you know what I mean? Like doctrines, right, Brother Rick? Like, if you didn't know you were wrong about something and you come to find out, like, wow, I was actually wrong about that, I think that's what that verse is talking about, right?
Unwillingly knowing, you're doing it out of ignorance. But once the truth comes and it's revealed, now you're responsible. What you gonna do with it, you know? Once you do, you better get away and turn the other way. Return back to the right path. You know, he's going to keep nudging you, like, come on. Like that shepherd does with that sheep. You know, you got to get that stick and whoop him in the butt a little bit. Come on. Get out of the path. Get back with the rest of us. Come on. Let's go. You know, there's going to be that tendency of that wandering sheep. But, you know, there's other the leader sheep, too, I think, in them flocks that everybody else follows, you know. There's that hierarchy, and I think that's part of what the eldership is about, what you're talking about.
Right on. So let's go ahead and read from 15 to 21. I'll go ahead and read. I'm going to use the Hebrew Names Version translation, so it doesn't have as much Hebrew as the Hallelujah Scriptures or the ISR. But I think they're pretty close to each other. If there's anything off or different, let me know. We're in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 15, and we'll go to 21. And the topic is about elders. We're learning about elders, and we're looking up the H2205, the Hebrew word H2205. It says, "The elders of the congregation shall lay their hands on the head of the bull before Yahuwah, and the bull shall be killed before Yahuwah. The anointed priest shall bring some of the blood of the bull to the tent of meeting. The priest shall dip his finger in the blood and sprinkle it seven times before Yahuwah, before the veil. He shall put some of the blood on the horns of the altar, which is before Yahuwah, that is in the tent of meeting. And the rest of the blood he shall pour out at the basin of the altar of burnt offering, which is at the door of the tent of meeting. All its fat shall take from it. All its fat he shall take from it and burn it on the altar. Thus shall he do with the bull as he did with the bull of the sin offering. So shall he do with," and I think at this point it's talking about the priest, right? "So shall he do with this. And the priest shall make atonement for them, and they shall be forgiven." It starts off verse 15. We're talking about the elders. Hold on, I'm getting feedback real quick. It starts off with, "The elders of the congregation shall lay their hands on the head of the bull before Yahuwah, and the bull shall be killed before Yahuwah." And then verse 16, it goes to, "The anointed priest shall bring." So I'm not sure if after that, when it's saying they or, you know, put, I'm not sure if, when is it referring to elders versus priests? Go ahead.
Well, I think that's why we started at 13 last time.
Okay.
We've gone through this one with that this was regarding whether when Yisrael sinned through ignorance.
Okay.
And then it be known to them. They have this bullock, and the elders are the ones that put their hands on this bullock. And we had noted that the elders took responsibility of the sin for the assembly. I mean, the assembly is a whole sin, but they're like this It's like a
carrier.
Yeah, there's a
big bear. Term.
But they're a smaller portion of the larger picture, and they take responsibility. They're the ones that kind of step up and atone for everybody else's sin.
Not atone for, but maybe they carry the weight and the responsibility of that, because eldership would be the people who are hearing matters, right? As we read already in the book of Exodus, Moses gave the positions to the elders to hear matters and make a judgment on it, on what's right and what's wrong. So when there's issues in a congregation, the weight, a lot of the weight is going to fall on the shoulders of the elders, because the elders made the decisions of what is right and what is wrong. So they're carrying a lot of that responsibility. So I think that's what you're probably trying to get to with this path, which is, I'm glad you went back to verse 13. That does seem important. And I think, you know, Rick, I think today let's cross-reference. If you got any cross-references, I'm not going to hold you back today. So whatever you feel led to go, if you want to go to the New Testament, Brit Hadashah, let's do it. But I know in the New Testament it talks about it's interesting. It talks about let the elders lay hands on you if you're sick and all that. But it also talks about elders being more responsible and held to a higher accountability, things like that.
Yeah, one of them would be in probably in Titus. If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife and the children are believers and are not open to the charge of debauchery or insubordination, for an overseer or an elder, as Yahuwah's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good or righteousness, self-control, uprightness, kadoshness or holy, if you will, and disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. That there, I think, really says a whole lot of what we've just been talking about.
What was that passage, Rick?
That was Titus 1, verse 6 through 9. In Acts 14, 23, they're also appointing elders from them in every body. So kind of where we're at right here in different locations. With prayer and fasting, they committed them to Yahuwah in whom they had believed. So they're putting their trust in these elders, as going with Titus, somebody that's honorable, set apart, that's really walking this, that is a leader in the studies or in the functions of the body, because that's really what we are. And we have to hold true that those ones that are put in that position are there to, I wouldn't want to say judge, but hold somebody accountable according to the word, you know, according to Yahuwah's standards, but with love and with mercy and kindness and gentleness and, you know, all of those things that it's describing there, you know. Can't be angry and upset and think you're holier than thou, as they say, you know. Kind of the rigid righteousness that the Pharisees held, but they were perverse on the inside too. So you've got to get to know the hearts of those that are in the head positions that are teaching. If you're going to follow any kind of group of people, whether it be a nation or a body like us of believers, where we gather together, you got to be able to trust those that are in those positions, that they are walking according to Yahuwah's ways, and because they're leading in a way where we're leading, whoever those leaders are leading this group, and their understanding of Yahuwah's ways, you know. So who is, that's kind of in a sense you're in a position of a priest, what you were reading beyond that, you know, where it talks about those basically holding the people's sins accountable and bringing them to before Yahusha. And you know, the high priest and the roles that all of those things play, we can look at those in our minds as an example of the kind of the role, you know. Yahusha is the high priest of us anyways, but, you know, he also has his disciples. He had leaders that were around him, you know, that were conveying and still leading the people after he was gone in the same way. Those were the leaders that were in the word. Those are the ones that heard the word speak. And that's those that are in this position are going to be bringing those kind of lessons to the people. He said studies and discussions, you know, some are going to have more information and more nuggets, if you will. I think those are the natural leaders of any group, you know, because that's Yahuwah's chosen ones. He's put that mantle on those people for a reason, whatever those giftings might be. But, you know, we all know that as a body, it's going to be visible to each of us, the role and the position of that person that's in those positions. That's what I get from the scriptures and all that we've talked about so far.
Right on. All right, so all right, so going back to Leviticus chapter 4, 13, like my wife brought up to read that, the laying on of hands, it seems like another thing I was thinking about was transferring the sins, like almost like transferring the sins of the corporate, the congregational, the assembly of Israel onto these animals and letting them bear the sin. So I know that Yahusha did that for us, but the opposite, it seems like the opposite is able to be done. Like you can transfer curses, but you can also transfer blessings through the laying on of hands. And so one of the scriptures I was looking at was in, I got to go back to it. My apologies. Multiple place. 1 Timothy 4:14 says, don't neglect the gift that is in you. Talking to Timothy, he was a young person, but given leadership position, which was given to you by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the elders. So there's this concept of being, having hands laid on you by eldership. You know, so there's something special going on there. I might not fully understand what the spiritual, what's going on there in the spiritual, but there's something about Yahuwah establishing leadership and then the laying on of hands seems to be something real special, even back in the book of Leviticus, like we were seeing. So, and also it talks about, you know, when you're sick, call for the elders to pray for you. And that's another passage, I'm sure, somewhere in here. But that's one way I was trying to I will connect Leviticus 4. Anybody else want to share anything real quick? Leviticus chapter 4, verses 13 to 21. All right. So we'll go to verse 22 now. Verse 22. This is not the word elder. It's a different word, but it's a word for ruler. But I thought we could read it. So we'll go over it real quick. We already mentioned it in the beginning of the recording, but Leviticus 4:22, when a ruler sins and unwittingly does any one of all the things which Yahuwah, his Elohim, or his El, has commanded not to be done and is guilty. So in other words, if a ruler does something he shouldn't have done unintentionally, didn't know it, verse 23, if his sin in which he has sinned is made known to him. And that's something to discuss right there. What does that mean for the sin to be made known to him? I've heard people say that, oh, as long as somebody comes and preaches it, that's good enough. And then I've heard people say, no, I don't think that's what that means. I think they have to get the revelation. They have to at least have some kind of conviction that what's being said is true. There has to be some kind of level of conviction there for them to be held accountable. It's hard to be held accountable when you really believe that that's not true. So how can you? So I think this, in my personal opinion, the way I would see it is when the person comes to realize like, wow, I actually was wrong. The moment you even consider that thought, you're responsible now for that information. Whether it is to seek the information a little deeper, do a little further research to get confirmation. But at least you have to pursue that to see if you actually were wrong. But I don't know if anybody in the group would disagree with that. Some people say, no, I think all it needs is somebody to come and preach the truth. And as long as the truth got preached, now they're held accountable. So what does everybody else think?
Well, the first part, it is sin.
Mm-hmm.
And because the word says, when a ruler sins. So it's it sin. Is sin.
It's still sin.
Although they don't know it or understand right. it, right? So
yes.
I think within this community or within the Israelite communities, for us that know Torah and know that we're supposed to be obeying it, we, especially the ones that are learning, like a baby, right? May yeah. not know certain unclean foods. That's sure. just usually the most simple example I can wind up using, okay? I didn't know I couldn't eat, shellfish. I didn't know that, but seafood was all good. And then we come and say they were sinning in ignorance, but we come and say, well, here's what the scripture says, and that's where the scripture comes in for exhortation, rebuke, and things of that sort of nature. That even if they still love their shellfish, I'm more on that side of, you see scripturally, it's very black and white.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot deny it. You're accountable. There's other scriptures,
other topics
that gotcha. Get a little on the gray and stuff like that.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
for at least a bare minimum, this is something where you can show them that they're
okay. I would agree with that. And again, this is, we're talking about elders, and I think we will get to the common people. Yeah, we'll get to the common people. Get to that next. But so what can we learn from this passage? Leaders can be wrong. You know, it's very possible. We're not, leadership is not immune to being corrected or being doctrinally in error. And, what I also see here is that there's mercy for that. You know, I don't see people are getting kicked out of the assembly of Israel. I don't see people getting stoned for these kinds of transgressions. You know, stuff that they didn't know was bad. Like if somebody puts pork in my food and I didn't know, you know what I'm saying? Like I didn't know. You know, some people can taste it and be like, yo, there's pork in my food. Why you put pork in my food? But if somebody eats a plate from somebody that gave them food and they actually put swine in there, that's not really their fault. But when they come to realize, like, my wife is big on this. And I back in the day, I used to be like, babe, you overreacting. She's like, no, I sinned. You know what I mean? I ate something. I was like, babe, it's not your fault. You didn't know. But she really takes it to heart and she'll get into a whole prayer and repent. And that's good.
Now I ask scripture to back that's it good. Up.
You do. Now you do. You do ask scripture to back it up. This is it. So, anyway, that's what I get from that passage. Sean, Julian, Brian. Go ahead.
I just know that, especially if we're talking leadership and we're talking eldership, there's such a heavy responsibility that it needs to be dealt with quickly, because the leaders are in a position that they're going to even unwittingly lead other people astray. I know even when I came to the knowledge of the name, when we were out there looking for fellowship, we were told some doozies, like some scary stuff. And we didn't know. We were still in a place where we didn't know. And there's a lot of stuff that can be taught that can be totally disruptive to somebody that's brand new on the path. So especially in a situation like this, the rebuke needs to come from the other elders. Now, I'm not saying a harsh rebuke, but I'm saying that, like, we need a restorative rebuke. It needs to happen quickly just because of the position that they're in, especially where you've got people coming on here that are fresh out of Christianity. Like, it's a big deal. It's a heavy responsibility.
That's a great point. Great dynamic point to bring up regarding this. Absolutely. Absolutely. The eldership, the teachers or the leaders are more influential than, for lack of better terms, the common person in the assembly. So with that being said, absolutely. Things need to be addressed much more quickly. I say common people because it's actually coming up in the next few verses. I didn't know what else to say. It's in my translation here.
John says he's a peasant.
Oh, peasant.
Peasant. That's horrible. Scum. You guys ever played the game Scum? King, the king, the president, the vice president, the king, the queen, scum. All right. Go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to give an example. I thought that was a really good point. It was like with the king Jeroboam, right, within the split of Israel. And I'm pretty sure it was Jeroboam. where he started making his own altar. He started making his own feast. He started doing this whole thing as a ruler, as a leader. I'm pretty sure it's that king. I can double check for sure.
No, yeah.
And then the people followed suit. I mean, here you have a king. Now, that's a really high position, obviously. And we don't have a kingship in this regard.
Right. We're not relating eldership to kingship at all in this fellowship. No way.
But in regards to rulers and people of influence, that's what I was trying to get to. The idea, like, you're making people of influence, especially people in this authoritative position, where people tend to listen more to, or I don't say even Daddy-o, right? Like, people may just tend to just flock and listen to him because they see him as this leader and stuff like that. But this is why we all need to be studying the word, because we need to know for ourselves if what's being brought from someone that's an authoritative figure is true, is trustworthy. If it's not, we can bring it to them, we can rebuke them, we can exhort them, things of that sort of nature. But some people fall in this more like following blindly, and that's something that we should not do. We need to know the word so that we can know who's sinning and who's not sinning, and we can all walk uprightly. So, but I thought that was a great point.
Nice. All right. Anybody else have anything they want to say before we move on? Brother Brian, I see you waving. Okay. Go ahead.
I think it's important to remember too. I remember like growing up in different churches over the years, and Pentecostal and Apostolic, and even talking about the kings and the rulers and stuff. We tend to, like, as just as human beings, like Israel. Back in the day, wanted to be like the nations, and they told Samuel that we want a king. And as human beings, we tend to like want to put someone on a pedestal and be like, okay, they're supposed to be all that in the bag of chips with the sword on the side. And then when they fail us, we are like devastated, and we want to stone them to death and all that stuff. But we have to remember that these people are human beings, and in the end, Yah is not a respecter of person. So when we talk about eldership and leadership, I think it's dangerous for us to put too high of an expectation on people, because if they fail, if you're like too emotionally invested in someone and you put someone on that high pedestal like that, it's almost like you're making them a god, and it's a very dangerous place to get to. And I think a lot of people make that mistake when it comes to ministries and fellowships and stuff. And you don't do it like, you're not doing it on purpose, but it's just subliminally, like on a subconscious level, it's like you have to be careful not to elevate people to like a God status. And so we just have to guard ourselves as the common people, as the peasants, we have to guard ourselves against that.
You guys are crazy.
Brian.
Nah, Brian, that's a great point, besides the peasant thing. But that is a great point, brother. Absolutely, 100%, man. Definitely, we got to guard ourselves from that. Brian, Sean, or Julie, I think I saw you waving your hand.
Something that Brian said, also, it's not a personality contest. And I've seen that play out in a lot of fellowships that I've been a part of. Someone that might appear to be really charismatic and great with their words and eloquent does not necessarily mean that they are the best person to be in charge or to be a leadership. You know, we have to remember that sometimes his ruach comes in that whisper. So it might be somebody that's a little more reserved, a little more quiet or analytical, or someone that takes time to process stuff, might actually be a very, very strong leader. So it's not necessarily a personality contest of who Yahuwah would even choose to be the leader. That's why prayer and taking a lot of time to pray and make sure that it is his choice of who he's going to put in place, not necessarily someone that our eyes see as being the leader. And sometimes those two things go together, and it will be somebody that's really charismatic. But that's not always the case.
Hey, hey. I want to preach to you today. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
You don't qualify just because you did that, bud. Don't get excited. I was trying to think of some real cool lines I've heard some preachers say over the years, but I couldn't think of any. Mm-hmm. Like good lines, though. Good, like one-liners that are like, ooh, that's good. But they like doing them one-liners, you know, getting you with them one-liners, you know. Anyways, let's move on to the next chapter. Oh, no, same chapter real quick. I just want to hit this up real quick. The common people passage. Check this out. Here's my thoughts on it. Verse 27. If any one of the common people sins unwittingly in doing any of the things which Yahuwah has commanded not to be done and is guilty, if his sin which he has sinned is made known to him, so same concept, same thing, he's just as human as the other, as the ruler, then he shall bring for his offering a goat, a female without defect for his sin which he has sinned. He shall lay his hand on the head of the sin offering. So he's also laying his head, you know, laying his hand on the head. So I wanted to bring this up because I don't know, I don't want to come across wrong as if I believe only elders can lay hands on others. No, other people can too. We're all called to minister. We're all called to heal the sick and cast out devils. So it's something that we can all do. So we can all carry each other's burdens as well. You know, we can pray for people who are in sin and bring that person in prayer before Yahuwah. So we act as a, you know, as a I don't know, for lack of better terms, but a mediator between the mediator. We're mediating to the mediator on behalf of somebody else that's in sin, but especially brothers and sisters, you know. So even though elders do that for the congregation, but we can do that for each other in general. So go ahead.
I think the only difference in this was in the first part when we were reading about the elders, it was when the whole assembly sinned.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like if this whole assembly were to do something,
yep,
and we had elders, the elders are the ones that are, you know, like if you have thousands and thousands of millions of people, it makes sense that you have a small representative of this group of people to come. So I think that was the difference versus an individual. Versus, so it's kind of like different aspects, but at the end of the day, they're all responsible. Once, you know, this is sins of ignorance, though. Of course, this is very specific, not blatant.
Good stuff. All right, let's go to the next one. Let's see what I have here. I have chapter 9. Verse 1. You want to read?
Yeah.
Okay, wife wants to read. Go ahead.
Wants what?
I'm not sure where to go to.
Okay. And it came to pass on the 8th day that Moshe called Aharon and his sons and the elders of Israel. And he said unto Aharon, take a young calf for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering without blemish and offer before Yahuwah. And unto the children of Israel you shall speak, saying, take ye a kid of goats for a sin offering and a calf and a lamb of the first year without blemish for a burnt offering. Also a bullock and ram for peace offerings to sacrifice before Yahuwah, and a meat offering mingled with oil, for today Yahuwah will appear unto you. And they brought which Moshe commanded before the tabernacle of the assembly, and all the assembly drew near and stood before Yahuwah. And Moshe said, this is the thing which Yahuwah commanded that you should do, and the glory of Yahuwah shall appear unto you. And Moshe said unto Aharon, go unto the altar and offer your sin offering and your burnt offering and make an atonement for yourself and for the people, and offer the offering of the people and make an atonement for them as Yahuwah commanded.
Okay. Yeah. So from that, what I'm hearing, I'm going past all the ceremonial things, right? Because obviously, you know, when it comes to sin offerings, we're not doing this via Yahusha. However, what I am picturing in my mind is the work that's involved. These elders are working. They're laboring. They're taking all these animals. They're doing all these things for who? You know, for the people, right? So that's what I'm seeing. Like, they're carrying this burden. And so that's a job of an elder. They're carrying burdens. That's what they're doing. So when we sit down with people and we're counseling people, or we're addressing a matter, we're taking on these burdens, we're carrying it, and we're bringing it to Yahuwah. You know what I mean? We're talking with them, we're discussing with them, but we're also bringing it to Yahuwah. you know, so it's you know, and elders are doing it for multiple people, you know what I mean? And so that's kind of what's going on in my mind. I'm seeing the physical in this scripture, the physical stuff of taking the animals and bringing it, but I'm trying to relate it with something spiritual and you know, the duties of an elder from what I understand in the Brit Hadashah. Anybody else want to chime in real quick? Nope.
They're responsible for disseminating information. Kind of what it seems like if you're over hundreds, over thousands, over 50s, right? I think elders are over a certain amount of people that they can be responsible for, but that they need to disseminate the information. Like here, Moshe is calling Aharon, his sons, and the elders. Mm-hmm. I think what's being spoken to the elders, you need to go and bring this message to the people. So you can't be hoarders of the word. You can't get fat on the word yourself. You can't, you know, you got to be able to share with others and have a heart to actually tell them the right message. So I think that's why they have a heavier responsibility, because they need to disseminate information.
Nice. Be accurate messengers. Mm-hmm. Nice. I like that. I like that better, actually. That was good. All right, let's go to chapter 19, verse 32. Let's whip through this. Let's see how much territory we can cover today. Leviticus 19, verse 32. We'll start at verse 30. And we might go all the way to the end. You must keep my Sabbaths and fear my sanctuary. I am Yahuwah. Do not turn to the spirits of the dead, and do not seek familiar spirits to become unclean by them. I am Yahuwah, your El. You must stand up in the presence of the aged. I think that would be that would be the word elder right there. In the presence of the aged, honor the presence of an elder and fear your Elohim, I am Yahuwah. Verse 32 would be the key verse. So it's important for us to honor the presence of an elder. There's a level of respect there. I've seen this done well in Christianity, and I've seen it done poorly in Christianity. You know, we see a place where people have too much respect for elders, where they like Brian was saying, they worship the guy. But we've also seen places where people don't have any respect for an elder. And it is like chaos in there, man. Like people are saying whatever they want to say. There's sin going on all over the place. You know, so much stuff out of order. I actually heard of somebody in Torah, a Torah teacher. I heard a testimony, and I'm not going to gossip. I'm not going to mention any names. But this is somebody that I respect and revere, that I've gleaned from. And I just heard this person is going through a situation where his kids were abducted. They abducted by the mother who's fellowshipping in this community under this leader who's in a divorce and whose children don't even walk in the faith. So his house is out of order. And he has a lot of, supposedly, this is what's going on. I don't have evidence of this. That's why I'm not going to mention names. But just to hear something like that, if that's true, and I believe it, you know, there's congregations out there that use Torah and use the name Yahuwah that ain't right. And I've seen some places with my own eyes and heard things with my own ears. But it's really, really... some people don't have any respect. Some people have too much respect where they won't call out sin and be like, yo, this needs to stop. This is a hot mess. Everything that's going on, we got divorces going on, women swapping, wives being swapped between different men and, you know, and all types of crazy stuff in the name of Torah and Yahuwah or Yahweh or whatever the names they want to use in these Hebraic camps. And it's a hot mess. You know what I mean? So. But honor is there. There's a healthy way to honor and respect elders, you know, where like between a husband and a wife, two people that love each other, you know, the husband is the head of the wife. You know, he's just at a higher position than the wife. That's just how Yahuwah made it. It's not that the woman needs to be like terrified of the husband every moment she's walking around and being afraid to even speak or look at his eyes or anything. But it's a level of respect that, you know what, they have authority. They get to speak more than me. You know, I listen to their leadership. I can give my requests. I can give my suggestions. I can really, really urge him to and try to persuade him to go this way. But I need to respect this person. You know, I need to respect my husband. You know, I need to have some level of fear there. You know, actually, I think that there is a scripture for that about, you know, women revering their husbands. You know, so go ahead.
I guess in this portion, you know, with this aspect, the elders, right? Just constantly in my mind, it goes that little question there is saying, is it really just actually talking about the age? Like this one, I think, is talking about the actual elderly, like rise up before the gray-headed, like before an older person. You know, like nowadays if we're on a bus, you know, stand up and let the older person sit down, mm-hmm. And honor in the face of the older ones because they should have more wisdom. So I'm kind of wondering in this study, I guess one of my behind the scene questions would be if elders in that position of an elder are those who are actually older, like not just young and wise. I know Timothy was young and wise and stuff like that, but like actually older.
I would say majority, yes. I would say definitely yes, because, you know, maturity comes through age. Scripture is very clear about that. But like here in this passage, it's breaking down two different categories. It's breaking down the age, or some translations say the hoary head. The ISR says the gray-headed. So that has to do with physical age. Mm-hmm. Unless you have genetics, you know, where your hair gets white and gray early. You know, there's some people like that. Yeah, special. You have extra wisdom at an early age. But it talks about the physical aspect of age, but I think here it also talks about, and you shall favor the face of an old man. Okay, the ISR says an old man, but that's the word elder, and shall fear your Elohim. I'm thinking, because the elder's been talked about so much throughout the scriptures, I would say it's definitely older people, but I think this is not just older people in general. I think it's people in leadership position. I think there's a distinction there. Because you can be old, but that doesn't make you somebody that's going to be over 50 or over 100, like Moses established. Mm-hmm. So that's how I'm seeing that.
Yeah.
Vincent, I see your hand up, brother.
Yeah, I was just thinking, well, you kind of just touched on it. I mean, doesn't necessarily mean just because a person's older. I mean, for me, myself, I mean, I wouldn't consider them an elder, especially if they're not walking in the ways of Yahweh. You know what I mean? So does age really matter, or is it more just like the like you said, the leadership position, or in someone in that position, I would be considered an elder?
Right. Let's think about it. Right. Let's say somebody just came out of Christianity this year, yeah. And they're 50 years old.
Yes.
Okay. They're up there, and there's somebody else that came out of Christianity 10 years ago, but they're 20 years old. Who is going to qualify more to have a little bit more wisdom in this walk? The guy who's been walking in it for, you know, 10 years, or the one that's been walking in it 1 year? So that's where I think age doesn't matter. And I think that's where it came to Timothy, where just because he was young, that didn't mean he didn't qualify, because it had to do with his level of wisdom. And Timothy, from what I understand, was learning Torah and everything since he was a little kid, and he was sharp. He was proving himself. You know, he had a testimony, he had a reputation, you know. So that's where I would agree, Vincent. That's why I don't think age is the qualifying factor to be an elder. There is a distinction between elder. Go ahead.
I think when it's referring, especially in the Old Testament, it's referring to an elder and as being an older person, that's because they've been following the Torah that long. You know what I mean? So they have that wisdom. You know what I mean? They have 70 years of wisdom because they've been following the Torah for 70 years. Where to say someone you know, barely, like you said, barely coming out of Christianity, and you know, they could have been a Christian for 30, 40 years, but you know, they still don't know the basics of the Torah, or they don't know the basics of what it really was to be to walking in the faith, I would say. So that's all I gotta say. Thanks.
Yep, right on, man. Thank you. And I think we covered a lot of the beginning in the first video. So if anybody wants to watch that, we covered, you know, how Moses divvied up the responsibilities with different men that were of age and everything, but mature. So not every man of age was chosen. That's the point, right? I'm sure there were tons of men that didn't get picked to have that position. And I think there's a reason for that, which we're probably not seeing all the details of how they went about voting and choosing, but it definitely will have to do with a person's level of wisdom, how they carry themselves, what kind of husband they are, what kind of man they are, how well they work. And we discussed it in the first video in the Exodus, how they can't be lovers of money and gain and you know ripping people off with their company and their business. You gotta see how they handle money. So all these things play a factor on choosing somebody that is not just an old man, but somebody that's actually in a level of authority. But that's a good topic, good discussion. Jeff and Catherine, go ahead.
It's about your mileage, not your age. It's your age, it's not your age, it's your mileage.
It's the mileage. Right on. Right on. I hear where you're going now. You're preaching now. You're preaching. Watch out. Watch out now.
I'm being serious, man. Thing in life.
Your audio quality is bad, Jeff, by the way. It's really bad.
That's okay. I already reduced it to what I wanted to say.
Yep. No, I'll finish it for you. That'll preach. See, that's one of those one-liners right there. That's a one-liner right there. It ain't about the age, baby. It's about the mileage. You know, it's about how many miles you put on this car. You know, I had my car for 1 year traveling to New York, New Jersey. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to put more mile on it than somebody else who just travels only in their city for a year. So, absolutely. So, it's going to be more broken in, more experience. So, the mileage has to do with how many miles you put on learning the Torah, learning scripture, and proving it, you know, showing it. And again, this is, I think when I use the word proven, somebody might get turned off like, oh, some kind of competition. It's not like that. It's very organic. It's very simple. It's very common sense. You know, so you need witnesses. You need people to be able to attest and be like, yeah, I like this guy is very trustworthy. He's sharp. He knows his scriptures. He's humble as well. You know, things like that. These things need to be, there needs to be multiple witnesses of that. And it can't just be your best friends either. Okay. That don't count. All right. There has to be people that probably aren't in your inner circle that should be attesting to how you carry yourself as well. But anyway, that's why elders get chosen by each assembly. But we'll get into that in the future. Well, good stuff. Moving on. Yes? Let's move on. What we got here? Leviticus chapter, we did 19, verse 32. Numbers now. We're done with Leviticus. Let's go to Numbers. I think this is the one Rick wanted to cross-reference, so I'm going to let Rick read this one. I put a star next to it, and I put your name next to it, Rick. Numbers 11, verse 16 to 30, if you want to read that and break it down.
Numbers what? Yes.
Numbers chapter 11, verses 16 to 30.
All right. Over here. All right, then Yahuwah said to Moshe, gather to me 70 men of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be the elders of the people and officers over them, and bring them to the tent of appointment, and let them stand there with you. And I shall come down and speak with you there, and shall take of the Ruach that is in you, and put on them, and they shall bear the burden of the people with you, so that you do not bear it yourself alone. And say to the people, Kodesh yourself for tomorrow, and you shall eat meat, because you have wept in the hearing of Yahuwah, saying, who is giving us meat to eat, for it is well with us in Mitzrayim, and Yahuwah shall give you meat, and you shall eat. I think, is that where you wanted me to end?
You can break that down for now if you want, but all the way to verse 30, I was planning on going to. But if you wanna break some stuff down right now, feel free to.
Okay. Fair enough. Well, I think it's pretty self-explanatory. We're looking at people that are going to be chosen, that are going to stand with Moshe before Yahuwah, and that anointing, if you will, or the, what's been placed on Moshe will also be placed on them. That's wisdom. That's the Ruach, you know, that he's talking about there. It's going to reveal the truth to these men, just as he has with Moshe. So they're going to have that same wisdom to come together in under any matter to, as it says here, where did it go here? I just lost it. Basically, they're officers that are over them. Well, what is an officer? What does that mean? Is somebody of an appointment that is put into that position? Basically, it's an overseer, kind of, in that position. Because we're going to look at other scriptures that we're going to come into that are going to bear witness of the same, that these people have to be loving and gentle, patient, you know, full of wisdom, of the word, of the Torah, so that they can make judgments appropriately. All righty. Where did I go next? Oh,
my wife wanted to jump in real quick, Brother Rick. Milo wanted to jump in. Give some...
Double Dutch. It's interesting that it's only 70 when we compare it to the masses, right? So how many people came out of Mitzrayim in Egypt?
Talk with them?
Over half a million people.
Bring the numbers.
I'm trying to find it. I thought it said 600,000 somewhere, so I'm trying to find a scripture with it. But there were thousands and thousands of people, and I said just the men alone, and yet only 70. So that to me just kind of stood out. Like, and it says whom you, okay, well, it says take 70. So there could have been more, but he says of those whom you know to be elders. These people were known to be elders. Moshe knew, because what did it say?
Numbers 11, verse 16.
Yeah, 16. Whom you know to be the elders of the people. These people are renowned among the, they're known among the people. So I think that's very important. But it just stood out to me. That was witnesses. 70. Yeah. 70 out of thousands and thousands and thousands of people. So.
Right on. Very good. And again, to point out what we were discussing, there it is right here in the passage. To bear the burden. We're called to bear burdens, carry each other's burdens. Now, in the New Testament, we're all to carry each other's burdens, right? But there's this another level, you know, of carrying burdens where we carry the whole of a congregation, you know, and we're not just doing it mentally or in prayer. We're doing it in action. Elders are actually, we're the ones making meetings, calling people together, addressing issues, addressing sin, you know, laying hands on the sick. That's a lot of responsibility, you know what I'm saying, where we're not really laying that on every single person. I'm not saying that everybody else can't do that, because everybody else should be doing it, and it'll make the work a little easier on the eldership, but if everybody else could pitch in and help out. But that's what I'm seeing from this passage, you know, also regarding the elders. They're carrying the burdens that Moses was carrying, so carrying burdens.
Take a look at this here, if you will. This is very interesting. I looked at what the number 70 means in the Hebrew, which is da'in, the eye to see, and the extension to understand and obey. Da'in further represents the primitive light, that is, the scriptural light of the word. Isn't that kind of interesting? It's kind of the eye. It's like seeing. It's exposing, if you will, revealing, in bringing obedience.
Like watchdogs, watchtowers, watchers on the walls.
They were the solid ones, the ones that were rooted and grounded in the Torah, that knew it, that could teach it, that understood it, that lived it.
I got something for you, Rick, to back that up. Overseers. Overseer.
Doesn't that something? It all comes together like that. That's kind of the what all of these scriptures talk about here. I want to read a couple here while we're at this moment, because there's some things that are very interesting here when you're talking about, and I got three different ones I want to bring. One is Acts 20, verse 20 through 30. It says, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Ruach HaKodesh has made you overseers. There's your word, overseers. To care for the body or the church of believers of Yahuwah, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock, and from among you, your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Now, that's kind of interesting, because that's another reason I believe that we need to have the eldership. When those things arise, they can bring some twisted doctrines in, and people are going to, go chasing after that stuff.
Brother, what verse were you reading?
That was Acts. Hold on a minute. I'm going to go back here again. Acts 20, 20 through 30. The next one that goes along with that is 1 Timothy 3, 1 through 13. This saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to the office of overseer or elder, he desires a noble task. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, meaning he has one person he's not sleeping around, sober-minded, he's self-controlled, he's respectable, he's hospitable, he's able to teach, he's not a drunkard and not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money, and he must manage his own household well, with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for Yahuwah's body? Yahuwah's body. So that's kind of another pretty powerful statement of who these elders will be. It's not always about this, but it's about what's in here, what and putting it all together. Above reproach, everybody agrees that this person is honorable, as you said, that we respect this person, that they know, that they have their lives in order.
How many people can attest to the awkwardness of some pastor randomly coming that you've never seen before and gets elected to be pastor, and he comes from who knows where? And next thing you know, he's the pastor of a congregation because he got elected by the board. You know what I mean? It's like, whatever happened to organically choosing someone from amongst your own community?
Right.
That you can attest to. You've seen his marriage. You've seen his family. You've seen his wife. You've seen his kids. So I know I've been to plenty of churches, where it's like, oh, we're having an election this year. Here comes a campaign, and so-and-so's coming. I've never heard of this guy. Never met him.
Another point here, brother, is that we're not electing a leader. It's not what we're looking for here. We're looking for overseers, because we're all going to be teaching, if you will, and we're all going to be bringing our agreement or disagreement. That's going to be brought out, and it's going to be maybe making some adjustments for people, but it's not one person's opinion that's going to dominate this body. That's where the eldership come in. That's where those people that each one of us respect, that feel that person is should be in a position to be able to be in agreement with us, whoever the other leaders might be.
Yeah, and I think the biggest point within that I got was when you're reading Acts verse 28, it says, which the Ruach HaKodesh has made you overseer. And it's not something, I feel like Julie made this point before, that it's not our selection, it's a matter of praying. Even when when they had to choose the new 12th disciple or the 12th apostle, they went to prayer. You know, they casted their lots.
They cast lots.
They cast lots, right? Right now before Yahuwah, so it's casting lots, and it's determining who Yahuwah is selecting. So it's not something that that we really should be doing. It's something that we need to be praying. Like, I agree, in prayer, it needs to be the Ruach HaKodesh that confirms it. We can't just, I know sometimes it's timing, like, I want something right now. Okay, we just want to establish this. And it's like, no, it's got to be in Yahuwah's timing. It has to be the one that Yahuwah selects. Because when I'm gathering and all this, when I start reading these scriptures, there was a big reverence on the elders. There was, in the sense of not worshiping, but in the sense of these were supposed to be trustworthy people that were feeding the flock. That means we were getting fed. They were speaking the word. They were supposed to be teaching. And we are supposed to be like almost quote unquote under some type of this authority. Obviously it all goes under Yahuwah, but that is a very important role. That is something that's not to be taken lightly. And it's not just for everybody that can speak eloquently and give a good message. It really has to be of the spirit. So that's the only point to me.
I agree 100%. That's exactly what this is about. You know, it's not, like you said, a popularity contest. It's not about that, as Julie mentioned. You know, it's really who's going to hold the line. Go ahead, Julie.
Just, I think that's why that verse, you know, about someone that's not motivated in it for gain. Gain isn't always money. Gain is power. Gain is a lot of things. People pushing their own agenda, sheep stealers, whatever you want to call it. There's a lot of reason why people might, in an evil way, crave that role. That's why prayer and making sure that it's his guy and not necessarily our guy that we want in there, because unfortunately, I think a lot of us been in congregations where people came into stuff seeking their own agenda, to push whatever they were trying to push, even if it be just a little tiny, tiny bit of false doctrine, just a little bit. They got like 95% of this solid stuff, but they got that little 5% they're trying to push a certain way. And that's why patience, long suffering, endurance, especially, you know, I don't know how long the people have been in this body. We went back and looked back at some of the videos from like months and months ago, and it seems like the faces have changed a lot. I don't know if that's true. It seemed to be. So like the long suffering, yes, we really, really need that eldership. We need that because the body is growing, but at the same time, we need long suffering and endurance and patience, because how well do we all really know each other at this point? And so it's a fine balance, and one that the people that are already leaders in this group know who they are, I think, in some aspects. But it needs to, I just feel like it's really so important. I think that's where a congregation or a body gets in trouble, when they try to do things too quickly because they think they should, rather than having some long suffering and let the Ruach come through and make sure it's done orderly.
I agree.
Well said. Well said.
Yeah, that's the patience. We're in no hurry to do anything, you know, and we're not really doing anything anyways. We're just kind of walking this path out as we're being led. And, you know, when it happens, it's going to be known if something was to arise. We're just trying to prepare for it right now to try to get an understanding of what it means to have scriptural leadership, you know. And then for us all to be conscious of it, so we can be aware of who we think is honorable enough to be in that position over us, if you will, or to lead us.
Hi, guys.
You're still muted. It's taking time. It's a little delayed to unmute you. Come on.
All right. We're in Numbers 11, and we're caught up to, I believe it's 18 we finished, so we're on 19 now. It says, you are going to eat not one day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days, but for a month of days until it comes out of your nostrils, until it becomes an abomination to you, because you have rejected Yahuwah, who is among you. And you have wept before him, saying, why did we come up out of Mitzrayim? And Moshe said, the people in whose minds I am are 600,000 men on foot, and you have said, I give them meat to eat for a month of days. There's your answer for the 600,000. You were right. All right, let's go ahead and continue, unless there's anything anybody wants to point out there. Could flocks and herds be slaughtered for them to be sufficient for them? Or could all of the fish of the sea be gathered together for them to be sufficient for them? And Yahuwah said to Moshe, is the arm of Yahuwah too short? Now see whether my word meets you or not. And Moshe went out and spoke to the gathered, the 70 men of elders of the people, and stood them around the tent. And Yahuwah came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and look of the ruach that was upon him, and placed the same upon the 70 elders. And it came to be, when the ruach rested upon them, that they prophesy, but do not continue. Again, there's what you were referencing earlier about the ruach resting upon them, and those 70 ones that had the ability to see and to basically make judgments, wise judgments on that, because it's the wisdom that is there partated about the word, the Torah. So that's what they're basing all of this is on, well, as we read earlier. Okay, however, two men had remained in the camp, and the name of one was Elad, and the name of the other, Medad, and the ruach rested upon them. Now that they among those listed, but did not go out of the tent, and they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and informed Moshe and said, Eleb and Medad may prophesy in the camp. And Yahusha, son of Nun, Moshe's assistant from his youth, answered and said, Moshe, my master forbid them. Then Moshe said to him, are you jealous for my sake? Oh, that all the people of Yahuwah were prophesying, that Yahuwah would put his ruach upon them? And Moshe returned to the camp, both he and the elders of Israel. And a wind went forth from Yahuwah, and it brought quail from the sea, and let them fall beside the camp, about a day's journey on this side, and about a day's journey on the other side, all around the camp, and about two amma above the surface of the ground. I don't know how much that is, but it must be a lot. And the people were up all that day and all that night and all the next day and gathered the quail. He who had less gathered 10 omers, and they spread them out amongst them all around the camp. They were sharing in this all together, this bounty that Yahuwah gave them as a promise. I believe it was all because he brought these elders and he put them, because maybe there was going to be some kind of chaos that maybe would break out. Who knows? He says they're talking about sharing here. So maybe there's something that has to do with that too. Who knows? And the meat was still between their teeth before it was chewed. And the wrath of Yahuwah burned against the people, and Yahuwah smote the people with an exceedingly great plague. Then he called the name of that place Kibbarth HaTawah, because they burned the people who had lusted. Dang. See, this goes back to that same thing I was studying today, what I was talking about. This is the description of that. The people that were coming out of Mitzrayim and all the things they did, and they're murmuring here, and he keeps providing for them, and they won't believe him and trust him. They want to keep going back. They don't. These are the ones just like that who can't cross over. They're not going to get to go into the promised land because they just refuse to believe. You've got to believe all the way to the end, right, Milo?
That's right. You know what we can learn from this too is as leadership or elders is, how can I say this without coming across wrong? There's going to be some complainers and some murmurers in a fellowship. There's going to come time where there's going to be some kind of complaint. They don't like something, or they might even be frustrated with a situation that they're in and frustrated with Yahuwah, you know, and it's our job to try our best to wake these people up and to remind them, like, this is not good. Let's not complain, you know, let's not complain, let's not murmur. But the other thing I was thinking of when I was reading this, as you were reading. Oh yeah, go ahead. Yeah, that. Go ahead. Because I'm losing my thought. Go ahead. You might think. Yeah.
But with this aspect of the elders sharing each other's burdens, though, I think it's very important. This is why it's not a one-man system, because they were complaining. They were grumbling constantly. And who are they going to? Moshe. They were even going to Aharon. I mean, at some points, Moshe says, Yehud, these people are about to stone me. Like, what do you want me to do that I'm bearing all these people? And I think it's necessary that literally it's shared. When he's talking about that burden, he is talking about, I think, that grumbling across the board, because it's too much for one person to be able to bear everybody's burdens, everybody's complaints, everybody's murmurings. And it's like, oh my goodness, you just get overwhelmed by it. So I think it's very important that it was necessary for multiple elders to be across the board. So, but you were going to talk about,
I don't remember where I was going, but
no, you were going to go over to don't envy for my sake.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. So these two guys prophesying, right? So sometimes you're going to have those people, like, as much as we preach, don't worship eldership, don't put people on the pedestal, you're going to have people that do it. You're going to have people that think like they're the only one, the elders are the only ones that can teach. The elders are the only ones that can prophesy. The elders are the only ones that can heal the sick and cast out devils. They're going to be like, yo, this guy's, you know, doing this, you know what I mean? Is it okay? And then it's going to be like, of course it's okay. They're doing the work of Yahuwah. I wish more people would do it. You know what I mean? So I can see Moshe rejoicing and knowing that. I wonder what those two guys are prophesying too. They're probably prophesying, yo, you guys are about to get some judgments. Get ready. Yahuwah's about to judge you guys and about to, something's coming, you know? So they were probably doing a good work. And, but anyway, that goes back to elders aren't the ones doing everything. They don't do it all. I think they have a heavier burden and a heavier responsibility, but that doesn't mean that they're doing everything. That was the point I was.
Can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
I do think these were elders, because in verse 26, it says, but there remained two men in the camp, the name Abad and the other Medad, and the Ruach rested upon them, and they were of them that were written, but went not to the tabernacle. So I do believe that these were elders that were supposed to come. For whatever reason, they didn't go to the tabernacle. I could be wrong, but
yeah, some translations say they were those in the registration. I don't know if that's military or what the registration was of. I don't know if it's, because I know some people are registered into the military to battle and do stuff, but I'm not sure.
Or just over the 600,000 that were like a registration.
That's a good question.
Mm-hmm. Kind of interesting, though, how Moshe forbid it. But the Ruach rested upon them, and they did. There's something there, too, you know, that whoever that person is, even if he forbids something, Yahuwah can supersede that.
Amen. Amen. We got to stay sensitive to the Ruach, regardless of what little rules or what little expectations we might have in our own little circle, right? Stay sensitive to the Ruach.
I had a quick note for It came on in my mind. I'm going back to Bereshit. Was there a time after the Tower of Babel where Yah appointed 70 angels over the nations or something like that? Because that sticks out. I can't find it where it's at in Bereshit, but that keeps on sticking in my mind for some reason, that number 70, going back to Genesis after the Tower of Babel. I don't know if anyone else knows where that's at.
I'll pause the recording to see if we can find it. All right, we got Jeff and Sakaya with their hand up. Jeff and Sakaya,
go ahead. I was just wondering, all I heard was the red registry.
Ooh, you sound like a robot. You sound like a robot. RoboCop. You sound like RoboCop just got hit by a truck. Brumber. Do the caller right. Number. Nah, I think okay, you guys are on on the internet. Brian's point about the 70 angels.
That comes out of the Book of Jasher, chapter 9, verse 5. When Abram came out from the cave, he went to Noah and his son Shem, and he remained with them to learn the instructions of Yahuwah and his ways. And Yahuwah said to the 70 Malachim, or angels, who stood foremost before him, to those who were near to him, saying, come, let us descend and confuse their tongues. So that must have been during the time of Babylon. The and all that.
So go ahead, Brian. I'll let you expound on that a little bit. Go ahead and share what were your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I was just thinking, I thought it was interesting that number 70, because it's you're looking at, he appointed the 70 angels over the nations. And I'm wondering if those angels, like, if, can you talk about, I have to do more study into it, because those
I know where you're going. Brian.
Did those angels rebel and then the humans replaced those angels, or, like, I don't know.
What do you think about this? I thought you were going to go in the direction of overseeing, that the angels were overseeing these people, and the number 70, like Rick looked up the number 70 and saw that it has to do with watching or seeing.
Yeah.
Talking about overseeing. So there's this relationship between the Malachim, the messengers, the heavenly messengers, angels are overseeing, humans, and humans oversee other humans. So there's like this overseeing kind of aspect or dynamic going on, even in heaven. That's where I thought you were going to go.
Well, yeah, where I was going was kind of on a darker note when it comes to like the fallen angels. I got to do more study for myself in that area, because I know that you have Brit Hadashah, talks about how we war against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness, and how you have certain principalities over certain areas, territories of the earth, and how we're warring against that. And I'm wondering if these angels originally were good, were there in place, were like the heavenly council, and they were good at first, but then they corrupted themselves and became the people started worshiping them and all that stuff. So God in his wisdom ended up getting the 70 elders established in Israel, and the 70 elders and have them replace this corrupted angelic table or council or whatever you want to call it. But I just thought that was because in the Brit Hadashah, we're called the sons of God, and we're not called the sons of God until Yahusha dies on the stake. So it's like we get an elevated status once we become once Yahusha dies on the stake, because in the Old Testament, we lost that status when Adam and Eve fell. We lost that status of being the sons. We become sons of Adam, sons of man, because we Adam rebelled and ate of the fruit. But it's like in the Brit Hadashah, when we're restored to our Abba, we once again have that status of being a new creation, being sons of Yah. So,
Brian, I think it's slightly off topic from the elders study. I think it's an interesting thought that you have going on, but I think it's slightly off topic from where we're, the direction we're trying to go in regarding eldership and its role in the assembly.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm sorry about that. Yeah, that number 70 just it just sparked my curiosity for some reason, but
right. So yeah, I mean, it looks like, you know, you got the, go ahead. I'll let my wife speak. Go ahead. I'm good.
I went to go back to the point of 27.
Drink your water.
When the two others were prophesying, mm-hmm. and Yahusha goes to Moshe, he's like, these guys are prophesying, like, forbid them. And I think Moshe's response is beautiful. And he says, in verse 29, and Moshe said unto them, envy you for my sake. Would to Elohim that all Yahuwah's people were prophets, that Yahuwah would put his ruach upon them. And Moshe got him into the camp, he and the elders of Yisrael. And I think, if I'm reading it right, that Moshe was rejoicing, saying, I would love that all the people can do this, in the sense of like this, this desire from an elder to see others grow, a desire to see the gifts in others being produced, not just it for themselves. You get what I'm trying to say? So I think that's a good attribute of an elder, is wanting to see others grow, wanting to see others elevate, wanting to see others prophesy and have the gifts of the Spirit and things of that sort of nature. They're really for others. They're very selfless, I would, if I had to put in a word, I would say they're selfless.
Nice. Good stuff.
Good, Milo, I like that.
Too bad.
Touche. All right. You know what? I think I'm going to stop the recording here.
One more.
What you got?
1 Peter 5:1-3. So I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness of the suffering of the Mashiach, as well as partakers in the esteem that is going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of Yahuwah that is among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as Yahuwah would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. I think
that's
a good way to, that brought up some more questions.
So this one was a comment. I don't know if you guys ever heard the phrase, don't do as I do, but do what I say, right? That's usually a older generation. Like my father always says that.
Old timers. Yeah, right? Old timers.
Always say that, don't do as I do, but do as I say. And that is, I don't see that as what an elder is actually supposed to do. They're supposed to be examples. Like that just, this verse just brought that up. Like, no, elders should be able to say, do as I do.
Right.
As I walk towards Messiah, as I'm following Messiah, as I'm trying to look like Messiah and be set apart as he's set apart, as I'm called to, take on my example. So they literally live by example.
Not do necessarily as, do as I do, not necessarily as I say.
So no, do as I say and I do.
Because your words, you know, are going to be an example of how you live. So you're going to really follow both, you know. If that person is really being forthright, you're going to really see who they are, what they represent. Are you going to want to follow them and have them over you? Maybe not. And that's where, as a group like this, with the prayerful expectations and believing that the Ruach is going to appoint them, and everybody will be in agreement of whoever those would be, and you're going to feel comfortable over their, I don't even want to like that, they're overseeing. That's really all it is making sure that they understand the truth and that they can start to walk in it, and that you have these that are almost, in a sense, kind of helping, you know. When somebody walks off the path a little bit, you go pull them back on. Say, come on, gotta come this way, you know, in a loving, gentle, kind way.
All right, let's. let's get Julie and Brian before they go. And I think we do have to go back to Jeff and Zakai, if I'm not mistaken. I wonder if that's their phone or they're still in on the internet. But I'll let Sean, Julie, and Brian go first.
I really love that Rick went here. I think this sums up a lot of things. And if you go even, first of all, if you start in verse 1 when it talks about the fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Mashiach, if you look at that, I mean, that's not something to like just desire on a whim. You're talking about sharing in his sufferings, bearing people's burdens. That's like some heavy stuff. It's not like this esteemed position of, oh, look at me. It is a position that comes with, you know, there's going to be pain and suffering involved. But if you go a little bit further in verse 5 and 6, I think sometimes in fellowship, you can feel like if you're not at that status level, you are like somehow beneath. And I love the way it speaks in 5 to the people that aren't going to be in those positions. When it says, in the same way, you younger ones, be subject to elders and gird yourselves with humility toward one another. For Elohim resists the proud, but gives favor to the humble. Humble yourselves then under the mighty hand of Elohim so that he exalts you in due time. So, you know, there's a changing of the guard eventually, and there's the ability for that to happen. That if you grow up in the body, and you grow up in the fellowship, and you grow up in Yahuwah, that your time will come, young one. I feel like I'm in Star Wars or something, but your time is coming. And to not take that as a knock that you haven't arrived yet, but it's a position with great weight and great responsibility, and that torch would be passed in time. And I think that kind of levels the playing field for people, so they feel that they're valued too, that they have something. Because then it talks all over scripture about how older women are to come aside the younger women in the body. That's that whole thing of, I'm going to grow you up in love, and I'm going to grow you up in righteousness, because there's a generation coming after you that needs to be grown up. And when all of you young women are having little ones, you know, we don't know. We think that we're in the end days. Well, everyone thought they were in the end days, and we truly do not know. But our job is to make sure the other ones coming behind are prepared as well. And I just love the way that's written here. Woo!
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Woo! You nailed it. You nailed it.
I heard nailed you. It. When you said Star Wars, it's like, B, I am your father. May my force be with you, my Ruach. That's what Yahuwah is saying to you, brother. That's what I heard when she said that. I don't know where that came from, but it was real.
So you mean to tell me that elders don't get an office, you know, nice comfy chair with a nice wooden bookshelf with some golden, you know, tabernacle of David, you know, nice stone tabernacle of David, and maybe a Lion of the Tribe of Judah picture in the background, and you know, a globe, you know, an earth globe with bookshelves of a whole bunch of theological books, and I get my own parking spot, and, you know, I get to get a special chair in the sanctuary, in the building. I get a special chair on the platform that I sit on that nobody else can sit on. You telling me, that's not part of the package deal? I actually got to suffer? Yeah. Yeah, I think that was very beautifully said, Julie. I couldn't have said it any better. Beautifully said. That's going to conclude. I think Jeff and Zakiah, my bad. Let me see how they're doing here. Jeff and Zakiah, how you guys doing here?
All right. So, yeah. So, what I was saying was offensive.
Much
is that better?
Okay.
Yep.
All right. So, the census in Numbers. Numbers 1, you can read about it. I'll just start quickly by saying verse 2. It says, take a census of all the congregation of the children of Israel by their clans, by their fathers' houses, according to the numbers of names, every male head by head, from 20 years old and above, everyone going out to the army in Israel. Number them by their divisions, you and Aharon and a man from every tribe should be with you, each one the head of his father's house. And it goes on and on to name the tribes and the numbers and how many were registered in each tribe. And it's dry reading, but it's there.
Right on. So that goes back to the point of Numbers, I think, 11, talking about those who are registered weren't necessarily elders. The two guys prophesying were in the military. And instead of being...
Right. They were registered.
Yep. And instead of being outside, I guess, because it's like, oh, the military guys should be on guard and outside and doing their thing. They're inside prophesying. I guess that was a problem.
I guess so. That adds a whole new level to the story. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. And Moses is like, hey, I'm glad they're prophesying. They're slaying more. Yes. They're slaying more demons and slaying more enemies right now. And so what are doing outside? Anyway, that's Brother D's version right there of Leviticus 11. All right, with that, we'll conclude. That was a good session. Very good. Good cross-reference. Thank you, Brother Rick. Thank you, everybody that participated. The recording will go up on YouTube. Shalom.